Fox and Trump, Trump and Fox. You know they're close. But do you realize just how close? This kind of relationship has never existed between a US president and a TV network. It is unprecedented. It's sort of a love story, so let me count the ways. First of all, the president loves Fox. He loves what he hears on Fox. He promotes the network and trashes its rivals, telling people when and where to tune in. A president has never endorsed a network like this before. Trump watches Fox and tweets about it and watches some more. Sometimes he hears valuable information, but other times he hears terrible misinformation. Sometimes he then spreads it in interviews on Fox. And around we go. Since becoming president, Trump has been interviewed on Fox every 20 days on average. Now, some of these are not really interviews at all. They're more like chats designed to promote his presidency. In this chat last week, Maria Bartiromo sounded like she was the president handing Trump talking points. Watch.
Well, you made a bold decision on Iran. I mean, this was incredible.
And Iran, look what's happening in
and
Iran.
Look what's happening now, the strikes and the protests. The people
Iran's
want economic
place.
Freedom.
Iran's so, a different place.
So let's take a closer look at this relationship. You can see how this back-scratching benefits both sides. Trump benefits from Fox's friendly segments and softball questions. And then Fox benefits from Trump's preferential treatment and constant promos. If you plug Trump, he might plug your book or your show. Or he might attack your competitors. Or he might do both.
You have been so great, and I'm very proud of you. And, you know, I'm a ratings person. You notice I always talk. Okay. Has anyone seen his rating? What you are doing to your competition is incredible.
Thank
Number
you.
One, and I'm very proud of you.
Yes, Sean Hannity. He defends Trump, bashes the media, turns a blind eye to Trump world scandals, and gives his guests free rein to call for the jailing of Trump's opponents. And that's just on the air. When Hannity's off the air, he gossips with Trump and gives advice about who to hire. So let's just underscore how weird this is. No TV host has ever had this kind of relationship with a U.S. president before. And to take it a step further, no network has ever propped up a president quite like this before. Sure, Obama had big fans on MSNBC, but there wasn't this kind of constant coordination. No one ever thought Keith Olbermann was Obama's shadow chief of staff, but that's how some Trump advisors describe Hannity. This is new, and it's weird, and we shouldn't get used to it. There's been almost a merger between a culture war TV station and a culture war president. Now, it started as a mere acquaintance. Look at this. Fox and Friends gave Trump a weekly spot way back in 2011.
The Donald now makes his voice loud and clear every Monday on Fox.
My message is a better message than anybody else.
Trump got to know Fox's priorities, he got to know his base, and Fox got to know him. Now, fast forward 7 years. He's tweeted or retweeted about Fox more than 1,000 times. And he's become close to Fox Uber boss Rupert Murdoch, who was once harshly critical of Trump. The two men now talk weekly, sometimes daily, according to the Washington Post. Now, Rupert reportedly opposed AT&T's acquisition of Time Warner, CNN's parent company. Of course, Trump opposed it too. The DOJ even tried to kill the deal in court, but lost. So what happened when Rupert struck his own deal, a deal with Disney? Oh, a very different reaction. Trump called to tell him congrats, and the same DOJ lawyers decided to give it a thumbs up. The New York Times editorial board raised its eyebrows last week, saying, hey, this Disney-Fox deal sailed through a bit too easily. Now, the DOJ says every deal is different. But let's get back to Fox. What really makes this relationship unique and unprecedented is the feedback loop. Trump constantly gets ideas and talking points from Fox, and then when he holds rallies, he repeats those talking points, and Fox carries those rallies live from start to finish. It makes you wonder, what would Trump do without Fox? A president has never preferred talk shows over his own intel briefings before. A case in point from CNN's Oliver Darcy this week, a dubious Fox News story appeared to spark a new Trump attack on Obama. The Fox story was sourced to a hardline Iranian cleric, not a reliable source. And that was the network's news side doing it, not the opinion side. Fox does have reporters who try their best, but the network is defined by its cheerleaders, like Jesse Waters, who dined with Trump at the White House earlier this year and got an autograph, or his co-host on The Five, Kimberly Guilfoyle, who is dating the newly divorced Donald Trump Jr. Look, they seem to be a cute couple, and I love a good love story. But Doesn't this radically affect her day job? How can any of her colleagues criticize Trump when the president's son's girlfriend is sitting right there at the table? Doesn't this complicate the entire network's coverage of the Trump family? I've got to ask. And speaking of quandaries, Lou Dobbs is called into Oval Office meetings so he could, quote, offer his 2 cents. Jeanine Pirro has talked to Trump about possible jobs. Pete Hegseth was rumored to be up for the VA secretary job. And Laura Ingraham was talked about as a possible press secretary. Now, they're arguably more valuable to Trump right where they are. But Trump has poached several others from Fox. Heather Nauert, Mercedes Schlapp, John Bolton, and more. And that brings us to Bill Shine. For 20 years, Shine was a super successful Fox News producer and a lieutenant of Roger Ailes. When Ailes was ousted amid sexual harassment scandals, Shine was promoted to co-president of Fox News. But he was credibly accused of covering up Ailes' misdeeds. He was named in multiple lawsuits. Shine denied all wrongdoing, but he left Fox under the cloud of scandal last year. That's when his friend Sean Hannity started lobbying to get him hired at the White House. And now, more than a year later, it's official. Shine is the Deputy Chief of Staff for Communications. I think we should ask, would any other White House have ever hired Shine? Now, I noticed the reporter started looking at Shine and his wife, zooming in on the Twitter feed belonging to Shine's wife, Darla, doing some of the vetting that maybe the White House didn't do. What the reporters found was shocking. As HuffPost described, Darla Shine has a long history of promoting anti-vaccination conspiracy theories. And as Mediaite reported, she posted years worth of racist tweets. Ugly, prejudicial stuff. I don't really want to read all of it, but you can see for yourself on Mediaite.com. Now, Darla deleted her Twitter account as soon as her husband was promoted. And now the man in charge of White House comms has gone silent. CNN has asked the White House for comment, but there hasn't been any. Now, surely they're not just going to lay low and wait for this to blow over, are they? Surely Fox News reporters will press the White House for comment, right? If they don't do that, if Fox ignores this story, it'll be another sign of the Fox-Trump merger.